That's what Russian bombs did to women in eastern Ukraine. You've probably heard about it. Russian forces attacked this maternity clinic in the city of Mariupol. And it's not the first time Russia has done something like this. Russian forces bombed a maternity clinic right here in Chechnya, a Russian republic, in 1999.
The war against Chechnya, it should have been read as a signal where this political regime was going.
There are some remarkable parallels between the wars in Chechnya and Ukraine. But Chechnya has been largely forgotten. Even though that was Vladimir Putin's first war, and what really kicked off his political career.
Chechnya is a grotesque miniature of what Putin wants to achieve in Ukraine.
So is Russia using the same playbook in Ukraine as in Chechnya? And can this help us understand what might happen in Ukraine and Europe? You probably know, Russian President Vladimir Putin is a former Secret Service agent. But did you know he actually started his career at the top with the war? In 1999, just a month after Putin was appointed Prime Minister, Russian tanks rolled into Chechnya. This is Chechnya, a majority Muslim republic in southern Russia and formerly part of the Soviet Union. Around 1.5 million people live here, mostly ethnic Chechens, a people that has resisted Russian rule throughout history. In the early 1990s, the Soviet Union collapsed. During that time, a political movement formed in Chechnya, of Chechens who wanted an independent state instead of being part of the newly formed Russian state. But Russia was simply afraid that this would create a domino effect, and that other regions home to ethnic minorities would break away too. So Russia launched its first war on Chechnya. A very bloody war that Russia lost. It brought chaos to Chechnya, but also a de facto independence. The first Chechen war increased instability in the region, which offered a breeding ground for radical Islamists. In 1999, a series of apartment bombings in three Russian cities killed hundreds and spread fear among the population. The Russian government claimed Chechen terrorists were responsible and started a second war in Chechnya. Who really was behind the attacks is still unclear. Several experts say they were coordinated by Russia's Secret Service, the FSB, to find a pretext for the war. So Putin could later boast that he was the one who had restored stability. What is clear though, look at this chart. Putin became very popular at the beginning of the war. And he did his best to reinforce this image as being the strong man protecting his country. One that he maintains today. And he was elected as president a couple of months later. Putin labeled the war in Chechnya as a counter-terrorist operation aimed at fighting Islamist extremism.
Окончательная цель – уничтожение терроризма в принципе на территории Чеченской Республики.
The 9/11 terror attacks in the US made it easier for Putin to sell the narrative of fighting extremists in Chechnya. There were indeed several deadly Islamist terror attacks in Russia in the early 2000s. But was the Chechen War really about fighting terrorism? We'll get to that. Let's look at Ukraine now. Ukraine used to be a Soviet republic. So unlike Chechnya, Ukraine became independent when the Soviet Union collapsed. But it still had close ties to Russia. Over time, Ukraine began moving away from Russia and its sphere of influence, and closer to the European Union and NATO. Putin hated that. He refused to accept Ukraine as a separate entity. First, illegally annexing Crimea in 2014, and inciting a war in eastern Ukraine. then in 2022 launching an all-out invasion. This is Chechnya's capital, Grozny. Thousands of civilians were killed when Russian forces seized the city. The United Nations later called Grozny the most destroyed city on Earth. And here's Mariupol in eastern Ukraine after Russia's forces occupied the city in 2022 after a three-month siege. Almost all residential buildings were destroyed. Ukrainian sources say more than 20,000 civilians were killed in Mariupol.
When I just kept seeing these images from Ukraine, after a while I struggled to differentiate between the two. And that was a horrifying realization that sometimes I couldn't tell which one was Grozny and which one was, let's say, Mariupol.
Lana Estimirova witnessed the war in Grozny as a child. Now, look at this suburb of Grozny, Novye Aldy. Russian forces ran a so-called cleansing operation here and reportedly executed at least 60 civilians in one day. That reminds us of the horrors of Bucha, which we saw at the beginning of the war against Ukraine. There, on the outskirts of the capital, Kyiv, Russian soldiers looted houses, tortured, raped, and killed civilians.
Be it in Chechnya or in Ukraine, the war crimes that we see, the human rights violations, they are all not side effects of the war, but they are indeed an incremental element of the Russian warfare.
That's Russia expert Sabine Fischer. Both in Chechnya and Ukraine, Putin failed to achieve his initial goal, a swift victory. So he is essentially using brute force to compensate for miscalculations in warfare, such as not expecting resistance. Putin is using the same approach as he did in his first war in Chechnya, says researcher Jade McGlynn.
Tactically, he learned that if you face resistance, you should shift to indiscriminate aerial bombardment and shelling to destroy that resistance. This is destruction that carries no direct military need. It reflects a complete disregard for the lives of civilians.
Is the Russian way of war especially brutal? We asked Sabine Fischer, who has just published the book about Putin's wars.
War crimes that happen during wars conducted by democratic countries happen, but they are deviations. In Russia, these war crimes are systemic, and they are really an instrument in the war, consciously applied by the Russian regime.
And this violence continues in defeated regions. Look at what happened after the Chechen War was officially over.
The ones who remain in Chechnya are living in pretty much an open prison.
Lana Estimirova knows what she's talking about. Her mother, Natalia, was an internationally renowned human rights activist. She was gathering evidence on human rights abuses in Chechnya when she was shot dead. The human rights organization that Natalia worked with claims Ramzan Kadyrov was behind this. He is Chechnya's ruler and known for his brutality. Kadyrov was installed by Putin in the wake of the Chechen War in order to bring the republic under full control.
So this kind of deal between Moscow and Ramzan Kadyrov in Chechnya and the establishment of these puppet regimes in the occupied territories, that is clearly something that also tells us important things about the future of these occupied territories.
This is what Sabine Fischer is talking about. This Russian map shows these Ukrainian territories as Russian. Almost 20% of Ukraine is illegally occupied by Russia. What Putin achieved with Kadyrov in Chechnya, he's now trying to do in Russian-occupied Ukraine, with these Kremlin-friendly leaders.
Люди, живущие в Луганске, Донецке, Херсоне и Запорожье, становятся нашими гражданами. Навсегда.
These regions that were once part of an independent, democratic Ukraine are now occupied territories with an illegitimate authoritarian government, oppressing freedom of speech and resistance. Sounds familiar, right?
This kind of rule of violence that they transferred from Chechnya to Ukraine, I think, is in many ways quite similar.
These are alleged filtration camps in the Russian-occupied territories in eastern Ukraine, where Ukrainians are reportedly interrogated and scrutinized for any sign that they might not be pro-Russian, and where they are being tortured or deported to Russian prisons, or even killed. The Russian government denies all of this. It's also something we saw in Chechnya, in the village of Chernokozovo. This detention center was notorious during the Chechen War, serving as a so-called filtration camp. It became infamous for human rights violations, including torture and sexual violence. So, to sum up, a lot of what is happening in Ukraine now has taken place before in Chechnya.
And it's the same situation now, only on a much larger scale. So the terror regimes, the torture, the extremely dictatorial rule that we have in the occupied territories is very similar to the situation in Chechnya.
Now look at the name of the main street in the Chechen capital of Grozny, Vladimir Putin Avenue. Kind of ironic if you recall who waged war in Chechnya, right? Because this is what the area looked like after the Russian siege. That was all part of Putin's strategy in Chechnya, rapid reconstruction as a form of propaganda. Russia has been allocating billions of dollars towards rebuilding Grozny. All this comes at a price, loyalty to the Russian president. But can shiny facades really make up for the trauma caused by war?
So it's one of the ways of enforcing control and kind of almost like imprinting on the mind of every individual that has to walk down the street. And even if they don't support Putin, they say Putin's avenue, not even thinking about it. So even subconsciously, it just kind of imprints on your mind. And I think that it's definitely a form of control and propaganda.
By doing so, Putin demonstrated his total power in Chechnya.
Chechnya is a grotesque miniature of what Putin wants to achieve in Ukraine. Not only in the way that he wants to crush any resistance, but also in wanting to replace one's history and one's ideology with something completely artificial.
Remember how devastating the destruction was in Mariupol, eastern Ukraine? Well, Russian occupiers quickly started transforming this city also. And look at all these newly built apartment blocks. It seems as if Russia is doing the same here as in Chechnya more than 20 years ago. Rebuilding the city to make people quickly forget what happened. But how does Putin achieve this? Well, he now controls any kind of information and represses opposition. During the first Chechen War, the Russian public knew what was happening, and many Russians were against it.
Putin learned the lessons of the first Chechen War, which was to keep the media out of the active war zone, to control the inflow and outflow of information.
He has ramped up propaganda throughout the years. And since the full-scale invasion of Ukraine, repressive laws criminalize any kind of critical journalism about Russia's war. The same now goes for the Russian-occupied territories of Ukraine. So we see there's certainly a playbook that Putin has been using throughout the wars in Chechnya and Ukraine, with certain tactics, using sheer brutality to crush any resistance, even as a way of making up for initial miscalculations, like in Ukraine. Ramping up repressions to control defeated regions, and hiding that with massive propaganda and censorship. These are the similarities. But what is different between the two wars is the international reaction. All the brutality of Putin's war in Chechnya didn't really lead to any knockback for the Kremlin.
There was this really famous example of on the same night when Tony Blair, the former prime minister of UK, was at the opera with Putin. There was a big bombing campaign in Grozny.
Those who remained ignorant of what happened in Chechnya, they wanted to be ignorant of it because it didn't serve their interests to fall out with Russia too much about it.
Western ignorance was also on display when Russia invaded Georgia in 2008 and then supported the Syrian dictator Assad in his war. But that changed with Russia's full-scale invasion of Ukraine in 2022. The world was shocked. And there was an unprecedented amount of solidarity.
Ukraine.
These countries are supporting Ukraine with weapons and humanitarian aid. After 2 years of all-out war, Western support seems to be waning. But Ukraine is still asking for more weapons and ammunition to regain its territory.
We saw Russia then adapt its tactics just like it did in Chechnya. And now it's playing a longer game and it's waiting for the West to get bored in Ukraine. Just like many of the journalists, Western journalists, got bored of covering things in Chechnya. And if the West does get bored and if Putin does subjugate Ukraine, then we'll continue to see this pattern repeated until somebody stops it or until it's too late.
Putin's playbook from his war in Chechnya has shown he wants victory at any cost. His political career began with the war in Chechnya. The question is, will it end with the war in Ukraine?